Please remain standing for the reading of God's word. The following scripture was given so that we may grow in grace and truth. 1 Peter 2:18 through 25. Slaves, in reverent fear of God, submit yourselves to your masters, not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those who are harsh. For it is commendable if someone bears up under the pain of unjust suffering, because they are conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. To this you are called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were like sheep going astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Let's pray together. Father, we give you praise, honor, and glory as the one true living God, creator of heaven and earth, giver of every good and perfect gift. On this Memorial Day weekend, we ask you to draw people who have been most affected by the military conflicts of this country throughout the years. We pray for those who are grieving. We pray for those who are serving. And in your presence, we honor those who have gone before us. We also ask you, Lord Jesus, by your Holy Spirit that quickens us and awakens us to blow through this nation like a tidal wave. Would you stir your people to bold, courageous faith? Help us to lean into these anxious times with unshakable confidence in you, our sin-removing, evil-defeating, hope-providing, death-conquering, life-changing Messiah. We ask that you would come and teach us as we open your word. We embrace this moment as a precious and priceless gift with hearts full of gratitude. We pray through Christ our Lord. Amen. Take your Bible and turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 2. We began an exploration of the New Testament letter of 1 Peter on Easter Sunday. We chose 1 Peter, not at random. We selected it mainly because it offers a clear and helpful answer to a question that many of us are asking today. What does it mean to trust and follow Jesus in our uncertain, ever-changing, and increasingly anxious world? What does faithfulness to Jesus look like right now in this present cultural moment? As we've already established in previous lessons, Peter was well equipped. He was uniquely prepared to give us an answer and to guide us through that question, because the cultural situation he found himself in was very similar to the one we find ourselves in now. Following Jesus in the first century Rome was controversial and risky and even dangerous. Christianity was seen as a strange, outrageous, fledgling, insane movement based on the teachings of a failed crucified rabbi named Jesus. Peter was personally discipled by Jesus. He was in an inner circle of three men, three dear, close brother soul friends. This was a very special relationship that Jesus had with Peter. Jesus invested a ton of time and energy and effort into Peter because Jesus would eventually call him to do some incredibly challenging things with his life. 1 Peter was written about 25 to 30 years after Jesus was raised from the dead. And if you listen carefully enough, you will hear the voice of Jesus coming through every word of this monumental letter. In our text for today, which is 1 Peter 2, verses 18 to 25, Peter continues a very intentional sequence of thought. There is a logic, and there's a reason, there's a rationale, and there's purpose here. And if you're new with us, let me say welcome. If we haven't already, clearly, we're so glad you're here. But if you're new and you just showed up and we're smack dab in the middle of this series, you're coming into it in an interesting part. If all you heard was this, it could be confusing and potentially even discouraging. So I want to unfold from a 15,000 feet above the ground level Peter's logic, and it is also the logic of the New Testament, and I think it also captures the spirituality of Jesus. And this is on your sermon outline. Peter begins, and this is going to be in 1 Peter 1. These texts are not going to be on the screen. It is very important to me and our leadership that you see that anything powerful that comes from this life, and especially when we gather together, it comes from the Word of God. It doesn't come from me, anybody else that takes this stage or the pulpit. The Word of God is powerful beyond description. And so when you hear the Word of God, you're hearing literally from God. So I hope you'll join with me in that expectation. 1 Peter chapter 1, you're going to see something that kind of goes like this. It starts like this. This is what God has done. This is what God has already done. 1 Peter 1, 3, Peter begins with this outburst of praise. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Here's what God has done. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We could stop there and talk into eternity and still not really fully address what we just heard. God is a God of great mercy. And if you have trusted and followed Jesus and you've really given yourself to Him and He's truly your Lord, you can say with certainty, confidence, I'm born again. And I'm born again into a condition, into a realm that Peter describes as living hope. The world is sick with dying hope. Hope that will fail. Hope that will ultimately disappoint us. Hope that's not hope at all. But what Jesus offers us is living. It's alive. It's in you. And you carry it with you wherever you go. And it doesn't come from you. You didn't generate it. You didn't give it to yourself. We can't work this up on our best day, our most spiritual day. We can't work up living hope. It was put there by Jesus Himself, and it comes from His empty tomb through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And there's more. There's more. It gets better. And into an inheritance. You guys know what an inheritance is. Church, you have an inheritance. You can say that this is unshakable, unchangeable, and this is mine, courtesy of the grace of God. This inheritance can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is not here. It's not out on the street somewhere. It's not vulnerable and open to attack. It is kept in heaven for you. Right now, right here, it is being kept in heaven for you. Who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed. You are currently being shielded by the power of God. This is a God of mercy. You are born again. The resurrection of Jesus makes it possible, and we have an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. It is untouchable. This is what God has done. He says, you've got to know that first. He establishes this, and he overwhelms his original readers with good news because they really needed it. As we've already talked about, persecuted, discouraged, beyond description, beyond anything we've ever experienced in this life in terms of corporate persecution for Christianity. What they were going through was unspeakably evil and vile. It may get there again, but not yet. So he moves from this is what God has done. He always starts with God. And then he says, in light of that, this is who you are. He moves from God to us. Go over to 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. And if you were with us a few weeks ago, then you'll remember that we looked at verses 9 and 10, and we called out seven specific statements Peter makes about who we are. This is the signature passage for us and our understanding who we truly are in Christ. And identity is a linchpin issue for a follower of Jesus. It's not some peripheral thing. It's not a throwaway thing. We have to know who we are. We got to know what God has done, and then we must get settled on who we are. And so here he goes. He says, verse 9 of chapter 2, you're a chosen people. One compliment after the other, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who brought you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you've received mercy. That cluster of verses is laden with Old Testament references and imagery, and we unfolded a lot of it a few weeks ago. But can I just say this? This is a glorious statement about who we are in Christ. We're chosen people. We are a royal priesthood. We don't need priests. We don't need special people or special buildings to gain us access to God. Jesus has given us unhindered access to God. And the moment you give your life to Christ, the Holy Spirit takes up residence in you. You are a walking temple. The Holy Spirit is in you, and now you are a priest. You can take heaven anywhere on earth you go. And when people are with you, they're with God because God is in you. We are priests. That's the truth. It's strange to say, but we are priests. Holy nation, God's special possession. God has ownership of us. So we don't get to claim any rights in terms of, well, this is what I want, and this is what I'm going to do, and these are my opinions about this. We have too many opinions. I know I do. And sometimes I think because I have an opinion, I should just air it out with you on social media, anywhere I want. And it's like, Jesus is like, hey, your opinion, you're God's special possession. You are owned, operated, and dominated by the authority of God. And this is not a threat. It's a gift. Part of the human nature, the sinful nature, is that we reject all forms of authority, especially the authority of God, as a threat to our independence, because we feel like it's going to enslave us. And Jesus says, no, this authority of God is meant to protect you and actually help you flourish and liberate you from the bondage of self-rule. Do you hear what I'm saying? So Jesus says, I've come to set you free mainly from you and from the false gods our culture is throwing at you left and right. This is what God has done. This is who you are. And then he says, this is how you should live. He declares good news. And then he says, now, this is how you live. This is how you follow Jesus, practically speaking, in your everyday life. In chapter 1, verses 6 through 9, Peter says that we should rejoice in the midst of trials. That's a lifestyle. It's a heart posture. We walk through trials, not faking it until we make it, or complaining because we've been treated unfairly. We do it with gratitude and with great joy because we know these trials are God's precious gifts, where He not only uses us to encourage others in the midst of them, but He shows us how needy and dependent we really are as life breaks us. These trials have come to test the genuineness of our faith and to showcase the unsurpassed greatness of the gospel of Jesus Christ. In chapter 1, verse 13, he says, in light of the fact that this is what God has done and this is who you are, you should, with a mind that's fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought when Jesus is revealed. You should focus on the second coming of Christ, which is something that we really don't do all that often, do we? Because we've got it so good down here, we rarely think about eternal things. They were not in that situation. Now, some of us think about eternity more than others. But Peter says, you should intentionally set your hope. You should calibrate your future expectations according to the riches of heaven, not the pleasures of earth. Chapter 2. He encourages us, in light of what God has done and in light of who we are, to pursue holiness. It's all through the Bible, all through 1 Peter. Pursue holiness. Specifically, he says, rid yourself of malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, slander of every kind. These are enemies of the heart. We should wage war. We should be intentional. We should put to death the old self and let Jesus resurrect the new self. Verse 11, abstain from evil desires. Back away, I preached about that last week. He doesn't say avoid bad things. He says abstain from sinful, distorted desires, which is a reminder that following Jesus is mainly about inner character transformation, not exterior behavior modification. Two very different ideas. Verse 13, it's going to get more intense, and so where we're landing today is really tender. But verse 13 says that we should submit to the governing authorities, which is becoming increasingly unfashionable to do because we love outrage and independence. There's bad kind of independence and there's good kind of independence. There's unhealthy and healthy. But what Peter's saying here is we should be so focused, we should be so laser focused on Jesus and living in light of what He's done and who we are, that we should be serving and loving our families and walking humbly with God and doing good things. We should be so preoccupied with that that the world around us is forced to take notice, not because of what we're saying, but because of how we're living. Live such a good life of humility and love that those who don't agree with you, especially about Jesus, will be inspired to worship the one true God. Now, these are hard and challenging teachings. They take us to the end of ourselves, the end of our selfishness, and they shatter the prevailing myths of our culture. And let me just say this. On behalf of everybody, we can't do any of this without God's help. The bar is high. If this feels easy to you, it's not biblical and it's not Jesus. This should call us to say, surrender. I can't submit. I can't love well. I can't stay quiet. I can't pursue holiness without God's miraculous intervention in my life, without the people of God walking with me in the midst of it. This is why we push groups so much in our church, because it is impossible to embrace this lifestyle of trusting and following Jesus alone. No one can do this as a lone ranger. This is meant for us to pursue together. We fall, we get up. We fall, we get up. We help each other. We encourage each other. We call out the good in each other. And we remind each other of what I just said. Everything I just told you at the beginning about this is what God has done and this is who you are, all of that is available to you to say to others. Please, let us be encouraging. Open your mouth and your groups in the lobby. Everywhere you go, when you're around another believer, remind them of who they are, even if it's awkward, because you can't over-encourage another disciple. You just can't. I saw somebody yesterday, dropped his daughter off at my house. Our neighborhood had a big annual pool party, and it was kind of an assault on my mental health. But that's another topic for another day. But he dropped his daughter off, and he's just one of those zany, spirit-filled Christian guys who came out of his car, and he was like, "Hey, Josh, you conquering Jesus-filled man of God, you overcomer." And it wasn't awkward. It was, I know this guy, and it was coming from a genuine place. And it was like the spirit inside me stood tall and said, "Yes, I needed to hear that." Because God put that word in his mouth because some things happened later in the day that kind of discouraged me. And I remembered what he said, and it was like he had to say it. He had to tell me. And it was powerful to hear the truth about me and who God is. We should be doing that more often, don't you think? We can't over-encourage each other with these things, because what God has called us to do is impossibly hard. We can't do it without the Holy Spirit and without each other and without the Bible guiding us and without the presence of Jesus this whole way through. Our passage for today fits under the "this is how you should live" category, and it calls us to a level of ruthless trust that I am often uncomfortable with. I'll tell you right now. We're going to walk through this passage in three chunks. And I just want to ask all of us to hear this with an open mind and keep it in its proper perspective. This is who God is, and this is what God has done. This is who we are. Now go live this way. Verse 18, slaves, trigger word, immediately. We're thinking, oh, how could you begin with the word slave? Well, we typically read the word slave through the lens of the horrible degradation of 19th century slavery in America. The situation in Peter's day was far less horrible than what we know about slavery in America. Mistreatment would definitely occur, but it has to be remembered that servants in those days, in that culture, were generally well-treated and were not unskilled laborers. They were often managers, overseers, and trained members of various professions. They were doctors, nurses, technicians, and skilled artisans. There was extensive Roman legislation around the treatment of servants. They were normally paid. Some of them were paid to the point where they could purchase their freedom. Their service was involuntary. Their legal status and social standing and opportunity for economic independence was clearly lower than others in that culture. But a better word probably for us to understand this passage and hear it as it was originally given is employee. Just a better word. So let me reword this, which is a dangerous thing for a preacher to do. I'm not going to reword the Bible, but I'm not going to change what it's saying. But so employees. In reverent fear of God, respect the people you work for. Not only when they're having a good day and they're treating you fairly, but when they treat you unfairly. It is commendable when people bear up under pain and they toughen up because they're conscious of God, they're aware of God in the midst of that pain. But if you're treated poorly and you rebel, what good is it? But if you suffer well and you are able to sustain your fear of God through the whole thing, it is not only commendable, It is rare. And it unveils something about God that may not be seen any other way. The key verse is verse 19. Being conscious of God. Bringing an awareness of God into your work. Specifically, your relationship with your boss. Now, that's harder for some to hear than others, but I don't know who you work for. And for some of you who work for yourselves, I'll just let you work that out. But this calls us to decompartmentalize our walk with God and be integrated. How you act and how you engage and how you affect others in your workplace is part and parcel of your spiritual health. Verse 21. To this you were called. What is this? To suffer well when you're misunderstood and mistreated? Why? Because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. So there's a calling here. You were called. And this is not some beautiful platform building, glitzy, shiny, awesome calling. This is a dirty, messy calling that nobody wants. To bear up under suffering, to acknowledge that the earthly authorities that we have, governmental or at work, is an extension of the sovereign hand of God. And to honor people and institutions in the name of Jesus with yielded hearts, who wants to do that? This is a messy, unpopular, and just very unattractive calling. I'm always nervous when people talk about the Christian faith in these overly triumphalistic, victorious, high-five me in the end zone of life every 2 seconds way. That is not what Jesus calls us to live. It is not reality. This is really hard. And whoever says otherwise doesn't know what they're talking about or they're lying to you. Now, there is joy and power and victory here. You guys know what a hope junkie I am. I mean, the word hope is tattooed on the back of our wall here, okay? The series is Living Hope. But this hope wouldn't be hope if there was no pain and no hardship. Jesus left us an example. And so here's one of the more uncomfortable implications of this example. Don't be surprised when you suffer. If Jesus endured it, what makes me think I'm so special not to? Whenever I find myself in the pity party, why me? Like, how did this happen? Why did this happen? It's like Jesus died on a cross. I love that Peter says he suffered for you. He did not say he died for you. He suffered. He doesn't say for your forgiveness. Although we know he did. He suffered for us to leave us an example. Very important. This is where Jesus becomes, he has to become, the most remarkable champion of humanity. Can you think of anybody you admire more than Jesus right now? See him walking through the unspeakable shame and rejection and fear and hardship of the cross, never defending himself, completely sinless. He assumed a non-defensive, non-aggressive posture toward others. He forgave the people who were nailing him to a cross. And how many of you are like me? You hear stuff like this, and you're like, well, that's Jesus. I'm not Jesus. I can't be expected to even enter that territory. That's the Jesus zone. I don't go there. And surely he doesn't really mean for us to follow his example. And so we start to let ourselves off and we allow ourselves to settle into spiritual mediocrity or even regression. Because we see Jesus as this superhero that can't be touched. But Peter doesn't let us do it. He says he left you an example that you should follow in his steps. If we're following in his steps, that must mean that we're on the same journey he was on. It's a journey towards suffering and pain. It's a journey of hardship. So we shouldn't be surprised when things happen in our families. We shouldn't be surprised when people get sick and die. We shouldn't be surprised when life doesn't turn out the way we plan for it to. We shouldn't be surprised. We all are surprised when bombs drop, right? But when we really let it sink in, we understand the doctrine of sin and what it means to live in a fallen world, and we look at the sufferings of Jesus, how can any of us be really shocked? We should be more shocked when good things happen. We really should. Because if you're in touch with who you are and how utterly deserving we all are of God's wrath, when good things happen, that should be more shocking than when bad things do. Verse 24, Peter goes back to the Old Testament, Isaiah 53, one of the messianic portions. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross. Now, that's a mysterious concept. He bore our sins in his body so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. Here's another quotation from Isaiah 53. By his wounds you've been healed. Well, healed from what? He just said healed from sin. The effects, the power, the penalty, the ultimate consequences of sin. Jesus has healed us not through painless victory, but through suffering and death and sacrifice. For you were like sheep going astray. Now that indicts everybody, right? We were all like sheep, doing our own thing, going our own way, following our own dreams, worshiping false gods, drinking from empty wells. But now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. Jesus entrusted himself to a greater judge when he was being falsely accused by an illegal trial, by ungodly people. When I say words like mistreated, falsely accused, misunderstood, harshly treated, what faces go through your mind? Who are the ones who've come against you? Who are the ones who've given you a raw deal? Who in your life is hardest for you to love and forgive?